What's up, guys? How you doing?
How was your week, guys? What would you do? Exciting. Something exciting to share with us.
Last week I had that film. So I was on the set and I just kind of this weekend had to get everything back in order. You know, people to the airport who came and worked with me that I helped out. And just teaching this week. But it was an easy week so far. What about you?
Hey, look, if you look at Ron, it looks like he has a halo there when he sits right there, right behind him with that like little white dish or whatever.
There's no white dish back there.
What is that?
It's my halo.
Okay, it's the halo. Larry, what'd you do this week?
You know, it's been a rough couple months trying to get to something that my wife and I always like to do. The first 6 months of our year is usually spent preparing for the world's toughest canoe race. It's a 260-mile race that you have 100 hours or less to complete. And we're a couple months behind, some truck issues, rack issues, boat issues, but Sunday was our first day to get on the actual river course, do about 24 miles. The water's really low, man. I swear we're going to need a shovel to get to the finish line because like we're paddling and like digging rocks out of this thing. We maintained a pretty good pace. It's an interesting thing. You know, I love it because it's always man versus internal man, and man versus nature. And I think that this is probably going to be the year that we get our money's worth considering how low the water is right now. So
cool. Well, you guys know that my son Kyle was down here. We did a Zoom call. I was on driving up to the actually to the Salt River because his wife wanted to see the wild horses. And it's always a hit and miss this time of the year because usually in the winter they're getting fed. And I go, okay, well, we may not see him, but we really lucked out. We found a huge group coming across the river and they were like right next to us. And it was kind of cool. And then we took him to Tempe, and there's a river that runs through there. If you've been down there before, that river. Yeah. And so we rented these scooters, electric scooters, which I had a blast with. I never knew that, you know, they were that fun. So, you know, we did that for the first time. And then we took them to Old Town Scottsdale. So it was fun. They just left out this morning.
Now he's moving, right?
He's moving to Japan permanently. So he's making this little loop to, because he was almost going to move down here, which we were excited about. But, you know, his wife's from Japan. He's got a Japanese wife. They decided to go back to Japan. So he went to Oregon, saw his brother, Chris, that you know. And then he came down, went through Vegas, came to see us. He's going to spend a night in Vegas again. I think they're heading to Twin Falls and then heading back home to Washington. And then she's going to fly out and then he'll fly out with a company that he's got.
How are you with that? How are you with the moving that far?
You know, it was really hard this morning. I mean, Deb had an appointment. She left, gave him a hug, started crying. I'm okay. I'm not going to cry. Right. As soon as, you know, he gives me the hug, I was like all choked up, and you know, I started crying. And then he jumps out of the car and comes, gives me a hug and says, you know, Dad, you come visit Japan, you know, we'll stay in touch. I go, yeah, it's hard. I said, you're going to know, Kyle, when you have kids someday, you just can't help yourself. Right.
You know, I got this inside joke going with Zach since he was probably four. You know, like I would go 14 more years, you're out, you know, and it's like 10 more years, you're out. Well, now it's like a month. And I'm like, you know, not that he's going to leave at 18, but that was the running joke. As soon as you're 18, I'm booting you. And I'm like, I'm going to lose him someday. Not lose him, you know, I mean, but he's going to move out. And it kind of hit me a little bit lately, you know, because he's just about 18. It's a fast 18 years.
It goes by fast. The coolest thing I think was last night I did my Zoom class with my black belts and I go, hey, guess who's here, guys? And Kyle comes in and, you know, he hasn't trained in years, but we just sort of, I picked up, you know, we started doing some Muay Thai and he'd feed me. And then, you know, we're doing a little bit of MMA and then we got the sticks out and man, we're just flowing. And all the students are like, whoa, that was so cool to see you guys go at it, you know, just full speed. And I go, you know, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, he's a great martial artist, but I think I burn him out because he started when he was like around five. And so I think, you know, his whole life was martial arts. So he kind of got burnt out, I think, but he still has it. You know, his kicks are so amazing. I told my students, I said, you know, of all the people I ever had to spar with, you know, when I was kickboxing, Kyle's the one that, you know, I'd have my guard up like this because he was so fast and he had such high kicks. And he'd say, well, you know, my dad's the toughest because his boxing. I said, yeah, because I would basically close the gap and get in there and punch you before you can kick me, right?
Yeah. Lauren's pretty good. I watched your daughter. Yeah.
Yeah. She can thump harder than most of the adults, man. You know what I mean? So It's crazy. I'm finally seeing her younger sister, who's 11 right now. She's about just over halfway to second degree junior black belt. And she's starting to get like her own little competitive edge. It used to just be like, she would laugh while she's getting hit. She had the spookiest thing about her. You're just wearing into her and she's like, you know what I mean? And she's got a whole different thing coming down. Now she's starting to grab a hold of that neck and squeeze harder, you know, and she's starting to hit harder and she's sparring kids that are way bigger than her. And she just kind of stands there and keeps going, you know?
Yes. So, hey, I'm going to change the vibe for a second. I always mess this up. May the fourth be with you, right? You know, and so may the force, we're going to have, may the force be with you, not may the fourth be with you. I always mess it up. Or what is it? Revenge of the fifth, or the Sith. God, I messed all these up, man. I am just so bad with it. Well, anyway, I wanted to push that because we're going to have Diana on. So Diana's going to come on our show, my wife. And as many people know, she played the magistrate on The Mandalorian. And we had like a special surprise. There's going to be some stuff going on. So we're going to pre-record this one. So what I'm going to ask people to do is if they could submit video questions. Like, we were just going to take questions, but if you have a video question, you could send it to R. Balicki, that's my name, at marsactiongroup.com. And just make it brief, please, but just submit a question for her and we'll try to throw them all on. It depends on how many we get. But I've already put it out to a few people and I've gotten a few video questions already. But I just figured, you know, if we get some cool, unique question, if it's multiple questions, we're going to have to just pick one person. But if it just think up something really good and we'll try to get it on there for you.
Yeah, that's going to be a great show. I'm excited about that one. I'm going to actually be in Cancun when we pre-record it. So, you know, I might be hanging down by the pool and you might be seeing me order a blue Hawaiian. I don't know. We'll see wherever my Wi-Fi is good. But you know, guys, what it is, it's time for What the F. And you know what? Ron's got an awesome one to cover today. So, Ron, why don't you cue it up and tell us what we're going to look at?
Yeah, I debated, should we just talk about this one or should I play the video? So you want me to cue it up and just play
it? I think we should see the video because you just showed it. I was like, whoa, okay.
Play it.
Try to fool you or deceive you into assuming positions that each position is dedicated to a certain demon. And when you do those positions, you are calling on that demon and the spiritual power you generate, they come like a parasite and draw that from you. When I was in martial arts, I did a particular style. One of the styles that I practiced was called Wing Chun. To get to the higher levels in the what they call black sash, equivalent black belt, you had to write an essay on a particular art or a particular technique in the art. Well, the one that most people couldn't make work was a technique called the Tan Sao. If you do it right, this will absorb any punch. I did research on it. Come to find out, this wasn't called Tan Sao. Originally, it was called Asking Buddha for Help. Demons don't care what you call it. What they're looking for is the position that draws them. So when you do that, they will draw to that. They will try to fool you or deceive you into assuming positions that each position is dedicated to a certain demon.
All righty then.
So what the?
I guess I'm going to quit doing Salem Town now. I just got to watch that. Might be bringing the demon.
Guilty.
You said something really cute earlier. Like, I'm going to ask for a lot.
Yeah. Lots of money. Ask. Yeah, put the Tan Sao out, guys. That's the new way to get things, you know, walk around with your Tan Sao.
Yeah, I seen that. That was sent to me. And I after watching it three times, I just kept shaking my head. I'm like, this can't be real. But, you know, I guess some people feel that way. And look, man, you know, I have nothing against religion, any religion. You believe what you want. But wow.
Hold on, I gotta let my demon in. He's at the door. I gotta let my demon in.
Hey man, you know, if you're gonna put yourself in a position to listen to that guy and believe what that guy's saying, then maybe you are letting the demons in, right? Holy crap.
Well, you think about that. I mean, evidently, I mean, I don't know who the gentleman was. I don't know if he has a parish. I don't know if he has, you know, a congregation, you know, but by the are people following this? Do people believe in this? You know, I mean, you could think of like this whole, like everybody talks about QAnon and Pizzagate or what is it? Lizard people and Jewish lasers, you know, wow. I just can't believe somebody would take that in, you know, but you think about it on the other hand, you know, like when I was a kid, Led Zeppelin, you know, my parents were really cool, but I heard a lot of people, they're like, you know, it's satanic music. It's, you know, it's a product of the time and the indoctrinating that you're in. And now Led Zeppelin's tame compared to like a Marilyn Manson or whoever's got the helm right now, you know, so.
Wow. Big time.
Yeah, yeah. So what the F? That was a... Well,
you know, that, I mean, you think about that, you know, it becomes almost like a cult, right? A belief. And some people who were hanging with that, they just assume that. I mean, I remember one time, you know, I was doing a seminar for martial artists and I was teaching meditation, you know, and it really is just being still. And mm-hmm. one person, you know, we all know, and he's changed now, I'm sure, but he just walked out and I said, hey man, what's up? You know, you're not going to join us. And he just said, it was like inviting Satan in. And I said, well, that's kind of scary, because if you're worried about that when your mind is still active and you're just being still, I mean, I would be scared to death when I fell asleep at night, right? It's like, you know, I think I made sense, but it wasn't, I think what happened was it was just the way that he was sort of indoctrinated, you know, by the you know, a group that they preach that. And so you think that, right? So I think that's maybe this guy, I mean, you know, he's doing Wing Chun and his Wing Chun instructor told him like, you know, hey, careful though, because this could bring in demons when you do your tonsao. You know, sure. Maybe if you close it like this, maybe if we see people doing tonsao like this, it's because we know that they're trying to keep out the demons. So we can't correct them and say, hey, you're doing it wrong, because they could be right, you know, keeping the demons out.
I like what somebody said here. They said, oh, he reads and meditates orange juice boxes because it says the word concentrated.
I got, I'm reading comments on it.
Troy's got you.
Yeah, I was just going to read that. A good friend of mine, Troy Miller, just said that I was the devil. So that's great. it's kind of crazy. People, I've seen, you know, this reminds me of, I mean, it's not in a religious aspect, but you ever meet the people in martial arts and they'll just say, this is... you cannot defend against this technique. It's undefendable, you know, or, you know, there's nothing, you know, I've had a lot of those people too. And it just, an instructor can indoctrinate you. And I look at it, maybe something like this guy that we just played the video on, he's just indoctrinating his people into that belief. And, you know, there's a lot of people out there, especially in the martial art world, maybe they're not using like the religious, you know, like God or anything like that, but they're just bringing that. I've met a few people who've had their students sold. There was a guy in, I'm not going to mention any names, but it was a guy in Illinois who had all his students just almost like he was the Messiah. They looked at, I think they almost said they had to bow to him. They had to serve him. They had to give him, bring him like drinks and, you know, there was a whole etiquette that they had to have around him. And I've seen it. And, you know, it's funny as, there was one guy, he was training this one guy, and the guy that he was training was klutzy. He wasn't real good, like just messing up. And he's making fun of him, laughing at him. And I said, you do realize that this guy is a doctor. And I mean, at best, the guy that was the teacher making fun of him had a high school diploma. And just because this guy was messing up, there's a lot of stresses to martial art. People get nervous. I mean, literally, like the running joke in martial art is, the other left. Because people get mixed up on their left and their right, because they just freak out and, you know, but you would just think, you know, in this guy, the point I'm getting to is this doctor who was training, who I ended up taking on as a student, he would be almost like this, just apologetic and very meek, while this guy berated him about how awful and bad he was doing it. And I finally went up to the guy, the one teacher, and I said, you do realize he's a doctor, don't you? He's not some schmuck, you know, he really knows his stuff, you know, like in life, you know, he's killing it in that aspect. In martial art, you could just see that. I think the nerves, everything got him. He was scared, you know? So once I got him, he started to train. I could see him come around, but it just got me how somebody who doesn't have half the education this man might have had can run the show, can tell him what to do, can make him feel a certain way or make him feel like follow his lead. Yeah.
Yep. So. That's scary though. I mean, that's just that's super scary. You know what I mean? But we all hit those moments. I mean, we probably all had something like that happen in our life where we kind of hit maybe our version of rock bottom. Maybe it's like true rock bottom. I don't know. But, you know, you just get in that spot where you're weak, you know, and somebody can reach in there a little bit and they might say something, or they might do something, and you might accept that direction or that U-turn or whatever it is that happens at that moment in time. And that's right. Hard, man. I mean, I always say that's one reason that we train so hard, right? Because, you know, we can't always make everybody the toughest, you know, martial arts, the toughest fighter. You know, like I always say, like you're only born with so much heart, right? You know, your life experiences are what give you that heart. But then after that, like we can't create more heart for you. But what we can do is create like a battlefield armor. You know, we can give you, you know, all these plates of armor that you can put in front of that heart to protect that heart. And that person has to have all of that extra skill set, endurance and training to be able to kind of pierce that armor. They're going to keep trying to pierce it to get to your heart. And our goal is to basically keep that armor so strong and in front that they'll never reach you, you know? So that hopefully never everybody sits at this crossroads and has to make a choice, like listening to this and actually going, yeah, he's right. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, I want to switch the subject because we've been working a lot on getting that website up and going to really make it rocking. You know, we all three do different parts. I mean, Ron's our guy. We were on him like, hey, Ron, you got to film this. You got to film that. So we're getting some really cool. Brian. Yeah. We're filling a lot of gaps that was missing. And, you know, Larry's got the technical part. You know, I'm working with him. We're going to start uploading a lot of video. We're going to have 2 live Zoom sessions a month that Ron's going to be given. So we're really trying to really take it to the next level for you guys. And sometime in May, we're going to go live. And we're doing this in different phases. You know, we're not doing it. So the first phase is going to be a total look differently to you. You're going to have more video that was missing. But we've got some great goals that we're going to keep expanding, you know, over the course of the next year or two. So we're kind of excited about that. Larry, you want to add something to that?
Yes, sir. I mean, I like this quote. I think this sums it up a lot. Little details equal big results. You know, one of our biggest focuses, or my personal biggest focus, has been on the FMA curriculum. You know, I've been pulling help from other people, students, things like that, to go through and look at that curriculum that we have already up there, look at the different gaps and see what's going on. So one of our biggest phases right now has just been going through and filling in those little gaps in the beginner material. At the same time, just like Cliff said, Ron's been filming like a madman every week, which has been great. He's been filming and even editing a lot of those pieces together that are missing for intermediate and advanced. So we're looking forward to putting that in there. I've also been kind of looking at something we talked about in our meeting this week earlier, which is just like maybe a couple of like terminology differences, right, within the structure, because we want to really prioritize the JKD and the FMA on the layout side of things and make it so that you guys can have the best possible experience. So when you're looking at a piece of paper and then downloadable PDF that shows you all of your curriculum A to Z, when you see that word and you start scrolling for that word, you're going to find that word. So we want to link all of that up so that you have a much better experience as far as your training goes. I know Cliff can probably agree with me. I mean, as the instructor, you know, you're working on many things, both for yourself and your students. And then they come to you with a random question. Like I probably do half the time to Ron, and I'm like, hey, what's Pala Sutsut number 14B? And he's all like, you know what I mean? And like, we have to go back to the book, right? We have to go back to the notebook. So I think having the continuity between the syllabus of the amazing Mars material that we have link up to those videos and kind of have that continuity there is going to make a much better user experience overall. And I mean, that, and like Cliff said, what? The number 2, that's a powerful number, right? 2 live classes. I mean, I'm stoked at just the first phase, and that's just the first phase, guys. That's May, right? So the list keeps going on.
We're not going to do it all in one dump. And that way, I think we could stick to the plan more. And we're not going to make promises we can't fulfill. So this is a good thing. Filming has been, it's been a lot. I mean, last week I had that, this other film, which knocked me out of a lot of what I was supposed to do for the week. But, you know, I'm back at it again this week. So, and then next week is just all filming. So we're going to get it done. There's a lot of like missing holes that I'm trying to fulfill that people have been asking for. So we'll get it.
Yeah.
You know, one thing,
really exciting pieces is going to be down the road. So We don't want to share that yet, but we're working behind the scenes. So we're changing things a little bit, you know, because when Ron brought me aboard and Larry, you know, we wanted to make this, you know, how's the best way we can efficiently, again, a cost for everyone. So we're one more to our yearly subscription and not trying to go month to month because we just don't have great results with that. I mean, collecting and penalties. So, you know, we're going to go more of a yearly subscription, but however, it actually works out a lot less than what you were paying on a monthly. So that's what we want to do. Keep it again. So it's giving you a better deal, more material, you know, bang for your money. And that's kind of where our whole concept's going to be.
Yep. Simpler is better. You know what I mean? It's like getting dinged every month for a silly monthly charge is just ridiculous. Why not pay for 12 months at a bigger discount than what you're even paying monthly and then still get more out of it? I mean, it's a huge win, you know? One of the things that I think that's really cool, and I mentioned this on the last cast there with, I think, Fari Bors, was that, you know, before it was kind of like talking to Ron maybe about like trying to get to some of this other material, it was a bit of a challenge, right? Because, you know, he's got a very busy schedule. And so obviously, I mean, think about it, like the rest of us, you know, a lot of us run schools or we personal train, do things and we teach. So the hardest thing for us to do is get back to like our own stuff, right? And what's been really neat about this process between us three is I've been watching Ron glow from filming and then doing a private lesson with me and then talking about calcifying something that I've known for 20 years as being a little bit more relaxed, but now he's making it like boom, 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 you know, and we're going through it and I'm going, this is amazing. Like, you know, here I am over 20 years with him and I'm just like excited. I'm doing one-handed cartwheels, you know, and so it's cool, you know.
You know, Zoom has forced me into it. You know, the funniest thing is, like, we all know this. When you teach, you can be a little lazy. You can walk around, check people, and look at it. When it's Zoom, I just can't stand there like this. I've got to do something. So it forces me to work out more. And it puts me on the spot to be a little more precise. And if somebody's got to follow the ABCs of it. And I've always tried to be an ABC guy, although a lot of people yell at me because I'll mix up orders and, you know, I'm human. You know, I look at somebody like Punungur Agrasaluthi when he taught me, you know, there was a video version he taught and then there was a static version. And some people will go, and I go, well, I have video that shows different of he and I training. So I've had to, you know, you got to shuffle things. And like when with Guru Dan, I'll ask him, do you want me to teach this first? And he's like, whatever you want. You know how he is. And I just went, okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a master list. And I did. So he would give me a lesson. And I'd go, oh, we did this and we did this. Oh, this one I didn't do. And I'd add it to that master list. And then I would just shuffle it to see which way it worked best for me. But as you mature and as you go, you know, I go, oh, you know, I got to change it. You know, and there are certain things that I do, like I know maybe a lot of people out here don't do the arts that we do that might be listening to this, but we do something called chi sao, sticky hand stuff. And I always remembered when we were into it, he would have us do these four gates at the start. And then later and I'm not putting Guru Dan down, this is just his way of doing it. But then he would teach Don Chi in it. So you'd roll and then you'd go into Don Chi. And then I go, wait a minute, we're already doing Don Chi in the four gates stuff. We're teaching it after it. So I swapped it. I go, why not learn this? Cause that's in that four gate drill and then put them into that, you know, like the four different gates. And it's just for me, as I matured, I switched it. And then as I matured more, I switched it again. And then I could just see my students look at me like, what, you change it again? And I'm like, I'm sorry. But the part of the mission statement is this will, you know, my system, you know, martial art research systems is a growing alive thing, the way I look at it, and it's always going to change, you know?
And well, Guru Dan was guilty of that. I don't know how many, when I was training him, every time I come in, the numbering system changes. Why? Because we know that. And I have to explain that to my students. Like they'll come and go, well, you did it this way. I go, yeah, like 10 years ago. I mean, you're coming back. I mean, I've changed it, right? When MMA came up, I was more side stance. I'm a little bit more square now because if someone tries a double leg takedown, I want to be able to sprawl, right? It changes, right? So we're not, you know, we don't go more sideways. We evolve to that. And that shows that we're, you know, we get it, right? If I was doing the same thing static, you shouldn't be training with me, right? But, you know, you're right about when Zoom, you know, you got an audience out there and now you're trying to teach like Puño Sombrada or something, right? And you're going, okay, this is challenging because they don't have a partner. So then, you know, I think, okay, I teach half of the side and then the other side, right? And then, you know, tell them where they, you know, they watch me, the partner, so that at least they can practice solo until they can hook up. So yeah, it makes you I think, a better instructor, because it's really challenging versus if you're just there and they have a partner. Right. So, yeah, I mean, I think I have evolved in this last year just because teaching Zoom, I mean, challenging. How do I teach this now? Because they don't have a partner, right?
Yeah, I've gotten really creative. You know, I have an autistic son, which, you know, plus if we get a chance, if you guys, I'd like to play a video that we made with him, but he ends up being my partner because I have nobody here. So I'm like, Sebastian, come out here. And, you know, he really doesn't know martial arts, and but he's helping. And oh my God, even with him not knowing anything, at least to have a body there for reference points. You know, I'm ready to buy one of those store mannequins. You know, that way I can just say, this is where you go. This is where it's at, you know? And, you know, it's tough. Zoom is tough. I appreciate it. You know, what do they say now that people are having like PTSD or whatever for, you know, for Zoom, you know, people are Zoomed out, but picture of going through this pandemic without it, you know, it's saved a lot of people, I think. And it's actually really saved me. My, you know, my seminars, movies, everything just dropped. And if it wasn't for Zoom, I'd be dead in the water right now.
Well, if it wasn't for Zoom, I wouldn't be able to train my black belts, former black belts, back in Washington State, right? And they wanted to train with me. And then when I said, hey, look, I'm selling the school, I'm moving, a lot of them just quit because they wanted to train with me. Now they're back in and they actually say, this works out, it's pretty cool. And then they'll go up sometimes and, you know, get together at someone's house and then they'll watch it. So they actually have a training partner. So, you know, I think it's cool.
I actually created a shirt that we're trying to get over the screen printer. I'm actually doing it and giving it away to all my students free. And it's hashtag fight the good fight, kind of like in a graffiti text on the front, you know, and it's got our logo and school on the back, but it's like, hey, this goes out to every single person that didn't stop, that didn't quit, that didn't allow this to hold them back. You improvised, you adapted, you evolved, you know what I mean? And you made it happen. I mean, I'm teaching grappling drills, you know, with a stick. Okay, this is how you do the chicken wing. You go over like that and you do it like that, right? And then I'm having them do it by themselves on the ground, you know, and like they're passing guard and they're all by themselves. I mean, it's just like, that's dedication. Like those are the people that put the hardcore in hardcore, not the people that would go to the gym and sweat it out and do everything else. Like the people that kept going over the last year on this format, that's true, like, dedication. That's true loyalty. That's true, like, just diehardness. You know what I mean?
Right.
So those people got a fond place in my heart, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. It's changed our world as we know it. And you know, even as people think that the vaccine's out there and people are getting a hang, you know, like, getting back to normal, I really think martial arts is going to be affected a long time. You know, I know people are still grappling and everything, you know, through this, but if you're at a school, I'm sure there's going to be a point where it hits you, because there's a lot of people who are, I don't know if they're deniers or they're just scared of the vaccine. And I respect that, you know, but they're also subjecting themselves to a potential, you know, virus infestation. And, you know, I'm scared for people with.
Well, we don't know what the variants could do. I mean, we just right. Because we got vaccinated doesn't mean that it's foolproof. And I remind my wife, I said, you know, we got to go back to washing hands right when we get back from the store or whatever, because that's something that's important, you know. And why? Because you just sort of get, hey, well, I'm okay, I got the vaccine. No, I said, we still have to, you know, it's something to help us out, but we can't rely on it yet. And I don't want to be, you know, the guy that gets it because I thought, yeah, it was cool, I'm vaccinated, right?
Right.
I look at it as like your health and nutrition, right? I mean, if there's been something that you've been doing that's kind of generally kept you pretty comfortable, confident, and safe all at the same time, then you probably ought to kind of stick to that. Vaccinated, not vaccinated, wherever you sit with everything, you probably ought to keep doing it. Like Cliff said, keep washing your hands in public places, you're wearing your mask or doing whatever it is, you know what I mean? So, or you're only potting up and training with certain people or only hanging out with certain people, whatever's kept you healthy up to this point, I mean, don't stop doing it. You know what I mean? Don't stop doing it. Like, it's that simple, you know? My mom, I think I've mentioned it before on here before, but my mom had this old saying, but she was just like, whatever you do, don't touch your face. And I was like, why, mom? You know, I was a little, you know, I was like, why? She goes, well, when you get older, it'll make your face break out more. So you'll have these things called pimples. And I was like, okay, didn't quite know and understand that yet, right? And then she said, but the other thing is, you won't get sick as much if you don't touch your face. only touch your face after you wash your hands really good, maybe when you're at home or this and that. And I thought, that just sounds so weird as a kid. You know, you're like, okay, mom, whatever, you know. Yeah. And along we went, and she's right. It's true.
I remember, you know, being in Asia. I don't know if you guys have ever been. I know you have, Cliff. Have you gotten to Asia yet, Larry?
No, sir.
Everybody walks around with a mask all the time. It's been common out there, you know. So, and I used to kind of almost like give them a look like, you know, and now it's like the norm here. And there's a lot less sickness. I was just reading a thing about how a lot of the typical flus and stuff have really subsided a lot since this COVID thing, because people are washing their hands, they're covering their face, a little bit of distance. And it's really, really done done a lot for like getting a handle on typical flus. So,
yeah. You know, my daughter-in-law, you know, cause she's Japanese, right? We're riding in the car and she's got her mask on the back. And I'm like, look in the mirror. I go, you don't have to wear your mask. And she, you know, when she told me, she says, it's okay. It's comfortable. It's comfortable because that's the culture. They're always wearing it. No big thing. Me, I'm like, oh, I wear this mask in the car. I can't breathe. But you know, that's what she's kind of was raised at. So it's not a big deal for her. Even when we're outside, you know, once I get outside, like we were where the horses were, we don't wear masks because, you know, no one's really close by. And if someone comes at it, we always kind of go right or left, but you know, they had their mask on the whole time. And cause it's just part of their custom. So they're used to it. You know, so yeah. And they didn't get sick the whole time because they were always wearing masks and kept social distance. Hey, I wanted to share this with you. Remember, Ron, I told you about how I couldn't find any diet root beer in all the stores. And it was driving me nuts. I don't have a diet root beer. So I got a solution. All right. Water. I get these like, you know, like these singles to go, like A&W root beer, and I get this carbonated water, you know, and I mix it together, and that way I get all the flavors. I got like pineapple, I got 7-Up, I got strawberry crush. I do all these things. It's good. I love these things. It's really expensive. My wife goes, why don't you just buy one of those, you know, soda makers? And I go, well, God, I go to like Sam's Club, get a case of these things. They're only like 40 cents a pop. I go, if I went and had to buy everything to do the soda maker, you know, why not just buy the cans? So yeah, now I got my diet root beer.
I mean, like I don't drink soda, but anytime I do taste it now, it tastes like super sugary to me.
Well, you know, I only do the sugar-free ones. I can't drink, you know, like Kyle was down here and he's like, you know, see drinking Cokes, and I'm like, with sugar, I'm like, oh, I can't, just looking at that makes me sick. So all these are all sugar free basically. That's why I go with these things, right? Because yeah, they're like no sugar. And
I can't have everything. That's awesome.
What's that?
He's got every flavor.
I got pineapple orange. We got one that's I don't know what it is a typhoon berry or something, and it looks like a blue Hawaiian. So Deb loves that one because it looks kind of blue and cool, right?
A little bit of rum, and then it's really right, you know. So yeah.
Now there you go, guys. I shared something with you, right? Go to the dollar store too, because you know, hey, I'm frugal. Because you look on Amazon, I go, hey, I get these for you know a dollar and six for a dollar. So yeah, I go to dollar store.
Dollar store.
Hey, next Wednesday, we're going to have Dr. Stephen Gold on. I don't know if people who know who he is, but he wrote a section of my book. He's a very unique man. He's going to break down a lot of Bruce Lee's passages for me. So if you've read the Tao and you've read some stuff, you've got to hear this guy. It's totally unique. I think you're really going to enjoy it. He talks about it in a way I've never heard anybody explain it. And he's worked, you ever see what was that show with Carrie Russell where she handles like political stuff, she puts fires out. Well, he was kind of that for the McGovern campaign, so he knows how to argue everything really well, and he's really good a debater. I'll say it, he could put people into a corner where they can't get out. And he works with the military a lot. He teaches through there. He teaches guys who are going up for like high brass generals, admirals, stuff like that. Just a unique person. He's trained with me for 26, 27 years now. He was in a really horrible accident. I think they wanted to amputate his leg. He was in a motorcycle accident. And he had suffered some injuries and it was tough for him. And that's when he had already sustained the injuries when I met him. But he got to a place where I would just put him I had a weight bench, you know, like for bench pressing, and I would just have him kneel on it because he can't stand well, you know, or long on it. And he would just kind of do a semicircle and he'd box me and spar me. And I had him doing everything in JKD just because he's such a fan of the martial arts. And just having him, like people who know me, I'm a knee-jerk guy. Like, you make me mad. I'm like, ugh. And he's, a lot of times my wife will say, no, do not write that. Do not say that. You send it to Steve and I'll send it to Steve and he'll send me back a response. I'm like, all right, I'll just shut up. Or he'll say, don't say it that way. Say it this way. Amazing dude. So I know I'm going on about him, but I promise you next week's show will be one to remember. So next week, Stephen Gold.
That's exciting. That's super exciting. So yeah.
Hey, we're going to talk about some injuries today, right?
Yeah.
Next week would be great with Steve too, but I don't want to dominate that with Steve, but he's a good person. You know, he taught me the difference though, between being handicapped and being disabled. Like, you ever have those people who get hurt and they say, oh, you know, I hurt my back, so I don't do this anymore. You know, that's really being disabled, you know, and his running joke used to be everybody has a handicap, even Tiger Woods. Now he really has one, but I mean, back then you get the pun is everybody, there's always something. You could always find a reason not to, you know, but then, you know, I had a student years ago, Barry May, he had MS, and he would get out there and he could barely walk. And he would go, no, I'm doing it. You know, I'd be on the ground. It was really bad, Cliff. I'd be ground fighting, you know, like we're teaching shoot and stuff. And I remember some people came into the school and I didn't notice it. And you see Barry, he's got his crutches and he gets out there on the ground and I get him on the ground. I'm like, kidding him, come on, Barry. And these people walked in there looking at it in horror because I'm beating up this handicapped guy, but he wanted it. And we trained and I was never malicious, but I could just see their faces looking at me like, oh my God. And they were gone. I lost them. But yeah, everybody's got an injury, including you, I, everybody. You know, we could always find a reason not to do something if you really want it. Yeah.
Well, I had that topic idea because, you know, we brought it up with Fireboards. I was watching his biography the week before we had him. And, you know, he was talking about early on in his training and basically how he had sustained, you know, some cracked ribs. He's like, you know, I mean, if you've had the cracked ribs, you know, you're not going to be doing a whole lot of like, you know, twisting, torquing, all that kind of stuff. So he had to sit out. But of course, the instructor was like, you're no good here. Go home, come back when you're better, you know, come back when you're 100%. And, but he refused. And, you know, he'd still show up every class. He'd still watch every class. And when he finally was able to physically participate again, he was 10 times better than he was, you know, when he had to stop because of the ribs. And you know, as a teacher, you know, of course, we try to encourage our students to keep going or to alter their training, you know. I always think about one of my students, like Ann Foley, for instance. You know, she kind of hurt her knee in the kickboxing class early on. She thought, well, that's it. That's my martial arts. I'm done now, right? I said, no, let me show you this really cool art called Filipino martial arts. Kali, Arnisa, Scream, let me show you this, you know. And I showed it to her, and then she went all the way to black belt with that, which is cool, and even started competing and doing stuff like that. So, you know, I mean, I know you guys have probably had it. For me, you know, I'm lucky. Knock on wood, I'm very lucky. 36 years of training, I've only had two major injuries from the martial arts. One was I broke my ulna, spinning back fist on somebody's head, just kind of missed the glove, pop, right? Didn't even know it happened. Still went like two or three more rounds. It wasn't until afterwards that I realized something was wrong, you know? And that was supposed to be a really simple, you know, heal. But you know, me, I slow down for a lot. Right. And, so I remember I was still kicking and stuff with an air cast. And I remember I got a leg cramp that night, getting out of bed. I put weight on it, didn't realize that the bone shifted. So then, you know, weeks go by and my bone meshes back like this. So then I go get the x-ray and they're like, oh yeah, yep. Forget the air cast in the regular class. We're going to break it, bring it back down. We got to put a plate in. We got to do all this stuff. So my recovery from that was far longer than it should have been, plus a surgery, right? And then I remember my second one being my ACL. That was probably absolutely that was the most horrifying thing ever, because I had coached quite a few people through ACL. Ron knows Alexis. Alexis had torn her ACL, and you were there when she tore it, right? And that girl kicked so hard, she tore her own knee. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's just like, man. And so I coached her through it. I coached several other students through it. And I remember when it happened, I was like, oh my God, it's my turn, right? It's now time for me to take my own advice and swallow the jagged pill. But you know, going through that, I adapted the training. I changed everything just like she did. She didn't miss a single class, guys. She was there for every class in that knee brace for 12 months while she was on repair. And so I just took that same focus, took that same plan and tried to make it come to life. And I still swear by that kind of stuff. But I did want to bring up four piece of cake points here, I think, that I've been writing about when it comes to injuries, and take it for whatever it's worth. You know, typically when you have an injury, I find that, you know, the first thing you guys go through is kind of the self-diagnosis phase, you know what I mean? Where you're just like, oh, I think it's this, I think it's that, you know, it's probably just this, it's minor. You're Googling WebMD in it, doing all that kind of crap, right? And then of course you get the real diagnosis. So you enter phase two, which is you are pissed off. You're angry at everything, yourself, your training partner, the world. You just want to rip everything and punch holes in it, you know what I mean? And then of course you go into like phase three, which is just like total depression about it, right? And you're just like crying yourself to sleep in your pillow or whatever it is, you know what I mean? I just remember like sitting in the doctor's office after it and after being pissed off and just like in tears, you know? And then of course, phase four is the most important, and that's that part where you actually start the healing process. You know what I mean? I don't know about that, you know, for you guys, but I mean, I know a couple of Rons, I'm not sure about Cliff's, but have you guys had anything where it's just like kicked your legs out from underneath you?
Man, I have had two torn biceps, and it was even too late to get fixed because I just kept going at it, but it was again from sparring. I've had two torn meniscus repaired through scopes. I had two ACLs, I had a shoulder replacement, and I got two knee replacements done, and this shoulder has to be replaced. But here's what I always
man.
Yeah, but here's the thing. I always, you know, I think as a martial artist, and I always think, look, I'm a leader, right? I got to go show my students who will, you know, nurture something forever. So when I had my meniscus tear, and it's just a scope, right? Friday, I went in, and Saturday, I taught a cardio kickboxing class on one leg, right? They're like, whoa. I go, yeah, because you guys are just creating this fear that, you know, I can't do something. And then when I had my bilateral knee replacements, I remember I went on, I think I went on Wednesday. I got out on Friday morning, I did this video of me walking without crutches. And then I came back in 10 days, and the PA's like, because a lot of people have walkers. She said, where's your crutches? And I go, I haven't used crutches. Well, I went one week, I went in and started teaching class, and I got so sick. And I said, why was I so sick? She goes, you're not supposed to be doing anything for 10 weeks. She goes, it's like having a heart transplant, all the blood you lost and everything. But, you know, again, I always figure, you know, you try to set, you know, for your students, like what we do as martial artists, you know, we kind of weather the storm. And I asked the surgeon, I said, hey, how soon can I get back to teaching? Right. Cause that's what we do. And he goes, well, it's kind of like this. He goes, that's the question. They always ask, when you run your own business, you're saying, how soon can I get back to work? When you're working for someone else, you go, how long can I be out of work? Right? Yeah. So he says, you're going to guide. I said, yeah. He says, that's the thing. I said, okay, well then I want to make sure at least in 3 weeks I'm doing it. But yeah, I mean, all my injuries that I got, you know, I remember the worst one, Ron, is when I first had my triad, I blew out my ACL medial collateral meniscus tear. It's the same one that Kurt Warner had when he played football. And so they put it in like a cast, you know, you can only move it. I think I could only move from 30 to 90 degrees or something. And then, so I'm wearing that thing for like 10 weeks or whatever. And then when I take it off, I think I'm just going to walk, right? And I looked at my chicken leg because, you know, I'm like, what? And I couldn't bend it, couldn't straighten it. And I had to go through therapy. And it was the most grueling experience to have that, you know, therapist just push on my leg, trying to straighten out, and it would come back. And I was like all frustrated. And so I talked to the surgeon. He says, okay, we're going to do a manipulation. We're going to put you under and we're just going to rip it one way and rip the other way. And so I remember I went to see a second opinion, and this surgeon said, no, it's not going to do a different thing. And I remember I was so depressed, you know, when I left that, because I couldn't hardly walk. And I was just like, just envision me like running off a cliff with my car, because it's like my martial arts, everything. And I was just starting my acting career, and I'm like, God, I can't even go to an audition like this. Right. And but I was determined. I said, I am. And that's what my surgeon said. He says, look, you're a black belt. He says, you're tougher than most people. You'll work through this thing. And so, you know, I would every day just hang weights off that and push it. And I would literally just almost black out from the pain and having, you know, crazy thoughts. Like, I don't know. I was like, in the Enterprise flying around, it was just like so painful. Right. Yeah. But I got over it. And I always attribute that to my martial art training, you know, the intestinal fortitude that we get from that, you know, that they got me through. I don't think I would have got through that hadn't I been a martial artist, hadn't I went through, became a black belt. I really don't think I would have happened. I would have just gave up and I would have been crippled all my life. So yeah, that's why I always, you know, I tell my students, I go, man, martial arts has so many benefits. I think I mentioned Al before, he was going to quit because he said, oh, it hurts and all that. And I go, Al, man, you just got to keep moving the body, using your brain. And, you know, he's back in and doing it again. And I told him, I said, look, you don't have to get taken down. You don't have to do all this stuff, but the right. fact that you're doing the motion and keep doing it is going to be important for you, for your longevity, you know, and how your quality of life is going to be as you get into your 80s. Right. So, and Ron, I'm sure you've had a lot of injuries.
Well, I mean, we all know the last big one that I had it wasn't a martial art injury, but it led into martial arts, and it's because of martial arts, let's face it. But, you know, I hurt my chest and I got that tumor and they had to go in and cut it out. And they cut part of the pericardium sac of my heart out. And I just thought, oh my God, this is over for me. I'm not going to be able to do stunts. I'm not going to be able to do martial arts. What am I going to do? And the doctor was great. He told me that's a whole story in itself, Bob, because I don't know if you know this part of it, Cliff. I went in, they're telling me I had to have open heart surgery to take this tumor out of the inside of my heart. So
I remember you telling me that was going to happen. I was like, oh, whoa, that's scary.
So the doctor I got was Ronald Reagan's doctor. So I'm like, oh, wow. Presidential doctor, you know, because the Ronald Reagan Museum is really close to my home. I live really close to it, and that's where Reagan lived up in, you know, like the Simi area. And so the day before the operation, and the operation was going to be on my birthday, on September 2nd. So on September 1st, I get a phone call, and they said my doctor stroked out. What? And they go, he just had a stroke. And I'm like, oh my God! Picture if he had it the next day while he's in there working on me. But so I lost doctor. I go, well, what's going to happen? I mean, I freaked out. And they go, well, you're going to have it on September 11th of all days. So, you know, I ended up going in and they had to cut one of the sides of my heart out because it was burrowed in, and they used part of my pericardium sac. And I thought, I'm done. And I asked the doctor, he goes, you're fine. And I go, what do you mean? And he goes, well, you're going to have an ugly scar on your chest. That's it. And I go, that's it. I could still do everything. He goes, you do everything. And I go, but the pericardium sac. He goes, look, never had a problem with anybody. Just go live your life. And I have. I kickbox, I spar, I do stunt work now. I thought that's it. And you know how I freaked out with you. You're saying you walked like the next day after this hip stuff, right? Or they had you up that day or something.
Yeah. When I was in, the nurses were like, couldn't, because they saw me walking around, because like, I'm walking, right?
Yeah.
So I had crutches, and they see me, they're going like, that guy is amazing. And then they heard that I had bilateral knee replacements, and they're going, God, what is this guy's, like, you know, Superman. And I go, look, I remember right before I went into surgery, I asked the nurse, she had bilateral knee replacements by the same surgeon, right? And I said, so how was it? And you know what she told me? She goes, oh my God, it was the worst thing ever. I would never do that. And I remember, like, you're kidding me. I told Deborah, I go, listen, I am going to walk. I'm going to go in with a positive attitude. I am not those kind of people. Right. I said, so I get up, I wake up the first thing. And I remember they said 6 o'clock was when, and I was hungry before it, is when you could get dinner. I just looked at the clock. I'm going, it was like 5:30. I go, get me back to my room. Cause I'm going to eat. But I just said, every time I'm just going to take a positive attitude. I don't care how much pain there is, whatever. I'm going to get up. I'm going to push myself. And I'm telling you, that made a huge difference, was my attitude. People keep asking me, I have a lot of people who watch my videos and YouTube, and they go, they're going for the surgery, same thing. I said, listen, I'm just telling you, I got myself in shape. really worked hard to get my legs strong because I knew that, you know, I'm doing them both. And I said, the big thing to take away was a real positive attitude. I said, quit looking on the internet and other people's who are just, you know, naysayers. Don't even listen to them. Just, you're not them. Right. And that's what I said. And I healed really quick. And in 6 weeks, they basically kicked me out of physical therapy. They just said, look, there's nothing else we can, you do everything we ask you to do, you know? And I'd go in with a really positive attitude. That's all I did every day. Positive attitude. I'm going to get past this thing really quick.
Well, what happened with me the week I was going to go in, Diana said, you know what? I want you to call Greg Nelson. You guys know Greg. And for those who don't know Greg, just look him up, look his story up. Just type Greg Nelson martial arts and watch what YouTube has on him. I want to have him on the show, by the way, you know, because he had a lymphatic cancer, I believe, and they didn't think he was going to make it. So I ended up giving him a call, and Greg and I fought before, and that's a whole nother story. But I'll tell you, his talk made a difference in me. He's like, look, Ron, he goes, they said I would make it, but they said, the doctor said the number one thing that in people, and I'll always remember he told me this, is they just give up. He goes, you know, so it's like they give in to the pain, they give in to the discomfort, and a lot of them perish because of it. And he said, you know, the way I looked at it, what like he's been through in the martial arts with Muay Thai and MMA and grappling and, you know, all the stuff we do. He said, I've been through so much pain. I go, can't be worse. It's not going to be worse. And he fought through it. And I mean, this guy is successful. He's one of my heroes. You know, I really admire Greg. So I took that into consideration. I just said, I'm not done. And I don't care how much pain I go through, whatever, I'm going to make it. So after the surgery, there's two things. I'm going to play a quick video, but I had the surgery September 11th. And you're like down a month from it. Like the first week I went, oh my God, I'm never going to recover from this. You know, I mean, I think a six-year-old could have whooped my butt, you know, and I'm quite sure that could have, I was weak. I felt like I was 100 years old, but around that 30 day mark, all of a sudden I started going, it didn't hurt when I coughed, you know, like, cause coughing is the worst. They give you this pillow to hug and everything for the month, but I go starting to feel myself again. So like about a week after, I got a call from the actor, Bren Foster. And he said, hey, Ron, he goes, we got this big fight and I want to do it with you. I'm like, dude, he said, open heart. He's like, you don't think you can do it? It's all sword work. And I started thinking about it. And I talked to my doctor. I go, hey, I got this thing with sword for a movie. Do you think I could do it? He goes, are you feeling up to it? And he goes, yeah. So I started going in. I started training with Bren. And, you know, within a couple weeks here, I'm just going to play the video for you real quick.
Wow, that soon.
That was about
awesome.
Mid-October. So I'm gonna play one last thing for you, but now that's, you figure about 5-6 weeks out of the initial operation. So then right after that, hang on, I gotta go back to this for you. Hold on a second.
Reset.
All right. Reset. Then when you're ready, little smoke and
So that was about a week later. And the reason I played the second clip is I just remember filming the whole day And I was, it was a really cool episode because I don't know the name of the actor. I love him though. If you, he's really big. He's in the new Mortal Kombat movie. He was in The Last Samurai, Japanese actor. But he watched us and he looked at me, he goes, "You're real." And I thought, oh, that's like such a cool compliment, you know, because he sees all the movie stuff. But he came up to me and said, "You're real." And I thought it was cool. But
you had to be so sore from that, though.
Well, no, that's where I was going. Like, at the end of the day, because you, Cliff, you know how many times you got to repeat all of that. You know, you do full masters and then you do subsections of everything and you do the turnaround on it. So I remember we were done and we went back to our wagons. They call them honey wagons. And I went to mine, Bren went to his, and I laid down and I passed out. I was out for an hour, I think. I got up and I was just like, oh my God. You know, and I just felt like I was 100 years old again. And I remember going to Bren's trailer and I'm like, and he opens the door and he's like, huh? And I go, "You okay?" He goes, "I'm exhausted. I was sleeping." I'm like, "Oh, wow. All right. I feel better now," because he was just as pooped as I was, you know, he was just out. And I went, you know, there is a chance that I could come back and be me again. And the other thing I did that year, right after that, that was November. So you figure December, January, February, I think it was like March. So it's a few months in, I fought in the Cold Steel Challenge and I won it, you know, the sword and the knife competition. And it was just this thing that, I know it's not a kickboxer or an MMA match, but it's exhausting and taxing. And I thought, I want to see if I could do this, you know, and I won it. And I was like going, all right, man, heart surgery. And I came back from it, you know, and it's just a lot of people, I think, would have just like been like, yeah, Ron, he had the heart thing, he's done. And it would have been maybe justified in a lot of eyes, you know, but I just, this is my life. It's my living. It's my everything. I need martial arts. It's my heroine, you know?
But one thing I learned too in life too, is that, you know, doctors don't heal you. You heal. I mean, if you go in a mindset that you're not going to get healed, you're not going to get healed. And you really think how the miracle, our human body, I mean, how we can create endorphins and things that in our own body, you know, that we can boost our intensity of our training and adrenaline. We're really unique that we can do those things, right? And I think as martial artists, we sort of learn how to tap into that. And where, because of our training, we go through these, you know, we go through ups and downs, we go times where like competing or something, and the average person who doesn't get involved in that all their life, you know, well, like my mother-in-law, right? She went through her knee replacement and, you know, she wasn't physically fit for it. And, you know, it's a lot more difficult. She's never done anything, you know, fitness related. So for her to even do a, you know, squat, it's like, oh, you're so sore, right? Where we don't think twice about that. You know, we're always sore, you know, all the time. I mean, you know, I tell people like, yeah, you get older, you just wake up every morning, you're sore as hell, right? I mean, everything, it's just life. But, you know,
Guru Dan would tell me, he goes, you know, Ron, I take glucosamine, chondroitin, shark cartilage. I go, do you feel a difference? He goes, no. And I go, really? He goes, no, but wait, Ron. He goes, when I stop taking it, then I feel it. He goes, so you don't realize you're getting a benefit. He goes, you know, no, I don't feel a difference. I feel me. But then he goes, then I'll stop taking those supplements. And all of a sudden it's like, oh, my elbow hurts, my knee hurts, my back, you know? And he goes, oh my God, I've slacked off on taking these things and they do make a difference in my life.
Even when I don't take my supplements on vitamins and my micronutrients, you tell a difference in your energy levels, right? Yeah. But you don't, like I said, you don't take them and go, oh, I feel like high energy. No, it's when you don't take them, you go, oh, I'm kind of sluggish, you know, or I'm a little slow on my thinking process. So micronutrients are really, I mean, underrated. I mean, people don't realize, you know, how they have an effect in our metabolism and our body. And so I started like really hitting those on a routine basis.
Hey, on our FB site, I'm looking, and Hector Gonzalez, he put up that link with Greg Nelson, the cancer survivor. If you guys are interested, go on our page and go to comments. You'll see that, and it's really well worth watching. So I just wanted to put that out there because, again, Greg, just amazing, brilliant, kind, super talented human being, and what the hill he overcame is just insane, you know, really, really amazing guy. It's well worth the watch. So, hey, I just wanted to do a couple plugs in before because we're coming up on our time. So we have Diana Inosanto. She's going to be on in 2 weeks. And if you have video questions, we'd like you to submit that. Next week, that's for the whole Mandalorian thing. So She was the magistrate again, and she's going to talk Star Wars talk. And then next week we have Dr. Stephen Gold, and he's going to be he's a doctor in philosophy, and he's a martial artist, and he's going to break down a lot of the Bruce Lee stuff that we have. And any other questions?
Yeah, I got Steve Hayes. I already talked to Steve, my good friend Steve, and he's such an interesting guest to always have on. So he'll be coming on maybe in 3 weeks or so. He was out of town. He couldn't hit us in, but he'll be back. So he already agreed to be on.
Coming up on the end of the season for May, I'm trying to pull in everybody's favorite little guy, the elusive ghost. You know who I'm talking about, Mr. Nikolai Sonyak, right?
Yeah, we have, I mean, it's we have a good range of people. I mean, you think about everybody that we're hosting, I think are really unique people who have something to offer and to contribute to the show. The, you know, the one thing on this show that we decided, it's not going to be all martial art. A lot of it is going to be just anything that just is self-help for us. You know, and we'll try to have fun stuff, you know, like our What the F sessions, you know, stuff like that too. But I'm really, really, really trying to create a different type of experience of these podcasts. You know, I've done a few of them and they're great. And there's some really talented people who are doing podcasts, but I kind of like this team that we have of three. And then I'd like to get it eventually to where maybe we can have somebody on, if not the whole session with us, but at least part of the session every week. That's the goal. So it's just the three of us this week. It's lonely, but we'll do it. We'll get it together. So, all right. So anything else before we close out, guys?
No, I'll see you next week in Cancun.
Oh, geez.
Been looking forward to this trip. Yeah, but you're gonna, all inclusive.
You're going to do our show, though, from Cancun, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yay for you. So, yeah, it's
cool. That's hilarious.
See, isn't Zoom amazing that it could give you that ability to do that?
Oh, yeah. I know, because it doesn't stop you. I mean, like I'll be teaching my classes when I'm there, you know, so it's not like, oh, I can't really go on vacation because I got the classes. Like, no, I'm taking it everywhere. You know, I told you I did a Zoom in our RV, you know, we were in there and did it from the RV and it worked. I go, hey, you know, I didn't have to cancel class or say, hey, study this while I'm gone. I still was able to provide a decent lesson inside the RV.
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
All right, gentlemen.
I love it.
We're wrapped for this session.
Okay.
So everybody, thank you so much for coming in and watching. Video questions for Diana about Star Wars, about Mandalorian. I've already got a couple and I don't even want to say they are, but there's kind of a couple cool ones. So, all right, gentlemen.
Wait. We were going to talk about also that we are going to be changing where we actually put the Facebook Live at, Larry.
Oh, yes.
Very good point.
Go. Yeah, we're excited about that. In fact, I'm gonna pull it for you guys right now. The cool thing is this whole thing coming to life. We want to start bringing it to you guys a little differently. We've given it its own name. It's birthed itself as Seeking the Path, which is cool. And so our goal and our aim as well is to give it its own location. So it's going to be a little bit easier for you guys to be able to find us, communicate with us, and do everything. So obviously you guys remember the Mars Action Group Forum is a group on Facebook, so we can post in there and talk to each other, which is great. But we also want you guys to stay tuned next week at its actual page, right? Facebook.com Seeking the Path Podcast is the page name. So you guys can join us there, which is good. That's where we'll host it live next week. And
yeah, like the page and encourage your friends to there, because then that way you will automatically, if you're in there, we can send you and contact you easier. Because I mean, Ron's got a great page, but it's a lot of his personal things in there, and we can't, you know, this way we can just send it directly out to you and keep you, you know, and share things with you. Like if we have an article, something, we can upload it on there so you can find it easier. All right.
So
good stuff,
gentlemen. Is that it?
Yep. Next Wednesday, 1:30.
So have a good week and have fun in Cancun. I'll see you from there.
I'll try.
All right, guys.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.